From the Tachi Palace Hotel and Casino in Lemoore, California, welcome to World Extreme Cage Fighting here on HDNet. WEC 24 Halloween Fury, full force. And it's no trick. We have a lot of treats tonight for MMA fans. We're glad that you could be with us, Kenny Rice, along with Olympic gold medalist Jeff Blatnick. We have a world championship on the line. Hermes Franca with the second title defense of his WEC lightweight title. He is going up against a young up-and-comer in Nathan Diaz.
Yeah, both these guys, explosive fighters. Nathan Diaz, complete package. Older brother Nick Diaz, UFC star now, so it runs in the blood. And Nathan is following suit, has a great record to date. Able to do it on the ground, able to do it in the standing position. He's well-rounded, lots of skills, and he's going to need them because he's going to be up against a formidable foe, someone that's also very good on the ground. But there you see Diaz, tremendous triangle, forcing his opponent, loss of air. Eventually, he'll tap right there. And Diaz really is a complete package. He's a youngster, but he's up against a real monster, the champ. Hermes Franca, tremendous jiu-jitsu artist, able to put people away on the ground. Also good on his feet as well. He can get up there and bang, but his strength without question is getting his opponent on the ground.
Diaz, interesting, said that he was a big fan as a kid growing up watching Hermes Franca. They're not that far apart in age, but he's kind of idolized him up until this point, getting a shot at the title tonight. Now we have two fighters coming in with a history that is a little scary when you watch them fight. If you've seen their two fights, this is the rubber match. Olaf Alfonso is getting ready for John Polakowski.
Well, you know, if you think of Diaz and Franca, you think a technical fight, but when you think of Polakowski and Alfonso, Olaf as he's known, you're talking an entertaining fight. These two can bang. Olaf just is out there and he lays it on the line. He puts his heart on his sleeve and the crowd absolutely loves him. He'll stand there and bang with anybody, as will Polakowski. He comes out of the Liddell stable. He was a kickboxer turned MMA, and he is really, really good. This should be an entertaining fight.
Well, the fans have been entertained by them before. They're getting ready to see who will win this rubber match in our feature event. Polakowski going up against Olaf. Olaf is standing by now with Ron Kruk. Ron?
Thanks, Kenny. He's a fan favorite and one of the most recognized faces of the WEC. Of course, I'm talking about Olaf. And Olaf, I know you're pumped to get back in that cage. The fans are excited. But you come in tonight having lost your last three. How important is it to get a win tonight?
It is important, but it's more important to me to make it a fun fight. So hopefully in the end I do get that win, as I'm expecting it though.
In 2004, you and your opponent, John Polakowski, put on an unbelievable show. So incredible, everyone dubbed it the fight of the year. 2005, you go in for the rematch, and unfortunately you were injured and were not able to finish that fight. Here we are, the rubber match, my friend. What do you expect from John Polakowski tonight?
I have no idea what to expect from him. All I know is it's going to be exciting.
Well, that's kind of the way MMA is. You really never know what's going to happen. But you said it. You always put on a show for the fans here in Lemoore. So what can we expect? Can you give us at least a prediction?
The only thing I can say for sure is that, you know, I get offers to fight all over the country, and I turn down every one. The only place I like to fight in the U.S. is WEC, because the people here, the fans here, the casino, everybody I work with, it's the best thing in the world, and this is the only place you'll probably see me ever fight here. And all I know is I'm going to put on a great show, and I expect to win.
Well, it's the fight that all MMA fans have been waiting for. Olaf, good luck to you. Kenny, back to you guys at cage side.
Welterweights getting ready to come into the cage. David Terrell against Mike Moreno. Two talented young fighters bringing undefeated records to the cage tonight.
A good pair of welterweights. Terrell's been in the fighting game for 4 years. Did his wrestling from eighth grade, also at Victor Valley Junior College, as well as some Muay Thai. So a well-rounded fighter, undefeated at this point. Carries some good skills.
Native of Pomona, California. He lives and fights out of Las Vegas now. 28-year-old who said he didn't know a whole lot about his opponent, just that he was wanting to keep his record unbeaten as well. He figured that, so we'll go in and see what happens. And that's his approach to this.
Now, in his corner, he's stacking the deck. He's got Nick Diaz and Matt Stanzel. Terrell, good-looking physical specimen, looks powerful.
And Mike Moreno, the 23-year-old Californian, an undefeated record coming into this fight. This is expected to be his toughest test, and maybe the toughest test for his opponent, Terrell.
Now, it's definitely one of these guys is going to lose, and they're looking at each other as the next step in their career. And they'll meet here. Moreno wants to keep this fight standing. Says he is a true ambidextrous. Either right hand or left hand, either one he can throw. But he really likes kicks, knees, and elbows as well. Full-time fighter, and it's been his dream since 1993 to be in the cage fighting.
Well, he's got the stare down already going, so he has that perhaps going for him before he even steps into the cage.
Well, it seems as though Terrell will want this fight to try to go to the ground. Moreno definitely wants to keep it standing.
There are the styles. There are the undefeated fighters. And Jimmy Lennon Jr. has the official intro.
All right, fans, here we go. A battle of undefeated WEC welterweights in the cage. We are scheduled 3 5-minute rounds of action. Introducing to you first on my right, he is fighting out of the blue corner, standing 5'8", he weighed in at 170 pounds. Joining us in the traditions of wrestling and jiu-jitsu, his undefeated young record stands at 3 wins, no losses. Fighting out of the Zions training camp and hailing from Las Vegas, Nevada, introducing the undefeated bionic, David Terrell. And his opponent across the cage on my left, he is fighting out of the red corner, standing 5'10", he weighed in at 170 pounds. Specializing in Muay Thai and Jiu-Jitsu, he is undefeated with a record of 4 wins, no losses. Representing Pacific Martial Arts, here is the pride of Pollier, California, introducing the undefeated Mike El Palo Duro Moreno. Our third man to the cage, the referee in charge, John Shorley.
Mike Moreno. He has the look of a caged lion as he continues to pace back and forth along the fence. He's the one with all the movement right now in the red and black trunks. His opponent is David Terrell. Something has to give. Both fighters unbeaten coming into this one, the first of what is scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds.
Watch for Moreno for a high kick to the head.
Moreno sweeping there with the in there with the left that misses, and coming back with a couple of punches is Terrell.
Well, double leg shot by Moreno, and Terrell just lifting him up with a couple of underhooks. Gives you an idea of the power that Terrell has.
Terrell's got a good nickname, Bionic.
And he's about to get his hands locked on a double leg. And he dumps Moreno down.
He slams it.
Moreno very calm in there.
Moreno looking over to his left, right into his corner.
Look at that, he got the full mount. Now Moreno is really going to be tested here. Does he have enough ground skill to survive being mounted? This is one powerful individual on top right now. You can just see him basing out, controlling the position, not trying to do too much. That's why he knew that Moreno was planning some form of a sweep there, and he was able to counter it. Stay where he is.
What's Terrell's strategy now? He tried to get a punch
he's
in
trying
there.
Trying to posture. He wants to get his head up if he can. Now he can rain blows down, but at the same time, he wants to be careful about losing him here.
Moreno active, and he gets it standing back up.
That's when you go too far to the front. If you give the opportunity a man to move his hips, attempt to sweep, or at least change the position.
Terrell and Moreno going right at it.
I haven't seen this very often. Referee needs to intercede.
John Shorley moving in there, pull up the trunks of Moreno. Well, we've heard about guys that feel like they might have gotten their pants knocked off in a fight. Marino, anytime he shows that kick, of course, Terrell has to be careful of that, but he comes back with the left jab.
And that was a real stiff left jab. It seemed that Marino acknowledged him, that it did sting a bit, fooled him. Oh, there's that high kick.
Marino got it blocked by Terrell, who takes him back to the canvas.
All that power again, able to bring that body down. Nice job of control.
Terrell got a good look at that kick, didn't he? He was able to get up just enough and deflect it.
Gives you an idea, though, that Marino can throw from anywhere. Seems Marino's learning the ground game here. Starting to scoot. Force Terrell to chase him. He's busy chasing, he's not hitting it. That's a good thing.
Terrell using a lot of energy here in this first round.
He's not posturing, he's bringing his butt up, but his head's down, and there's no room between the chests to get any real blows in.
What about Terrell's strategy? Marino seems to be adapting here on the ground.
Very nice job, yeah, he's holding the head. Terrell's not able to posture up, get that head high. Once the head's high, you can rain blows down. And he's kind of diving into the blows. That gives that momentum to roll with. And that's why those elbows should just be dropped, small drops. Here comes the pass. Trying to get the side. This is the technical part of the ground game. And he does, he's off to the side now. Better position to strike from.
Terrell is not able to get the leverage yet to get those shots to be effective here on the ground here in the early going.
This is a very technical fight. A lot going on here. And he's working his way back into a least half guard here. He might have that right leg in there. I believe he does. Back to half guard. Nice defense by Marino.
Marino has listened carefully to his corner, and he has adapted well throughout this first round.
Well, neither one of these two seem gassed in any way. They seem in control, composed. They're even.
Well, they both come in saying they're in great shape. They look in great shape, and they were both very confident.
But Terrell's back a little bit now. He's throwing those punches too far forward to be really effective.
And that's round one.
Yeah. Check it out. See, the only thing you need to do right
That's going to be really interesting, you know, what they say in the corners. I like what Terrell was able to do. Go for the takedown when he needed it, able to finish the takedown. Good control, but at the same time, Marino was fairly effective at countering using guard.
Let's take a look here at the takedown in the early going, Jeff.
This is when he plowed him into the fence, finally got his hands locked. And once you get your hands locked, now you got the hips. Drags him away from the fence, lifts him, slams him. Well done, textbook. Once you get him in the hair, rotate his hips. It's almost like a seesaw. Rotate the hips one way, head comes down the other, invert slam. Well done. Everything that's illegal in the sport of wrestling. Not allowed to slam the man. You got to return him safely. And they both look good. They both look focused. I think we're going to get a repeat of the same type of round we saw the first time.
Are you doing two or one?
Picks up the striking.
You ready?
Terrell and Marino, round two underway.
Can he strike and hold off the more powerful Terrell from getting a takedown?
Terrell in the gray, Marino in the red. What about that frame there? You see the kicking power of Marino if he can get it in there, and Terrell wants to make sure that doesn't happen as he gets a couple of lefts in. And now he's trying for a single leg takedown.
Had the knee come up, he sees the one leg, drove him to the fence, locked his hands again.
This is almost a replay of the first round, except
exactly
not
how
the
it
slam.
Started. Except he didn't get his biggest slam at the end of it. But solid position. Marino overhooking the one arm, keeping him from striking. You'll also see the bottom fighter grab wrists and glove to try to hold the hands and control the arm, not let him strike.
There we go.
Here the corner of Marino. They're just about 5 feet away from us here. Action taking place right in front of us. Just a minute here into the second round.
Marino doing a better job here now of crawling away, creating that distance. It's hard for Terrell now to punch and reach the head. He'll fall a little bit short. Now he's over towards the side. Marino trying to stop him from mounting. That's why he's crossing the legs. Corner yelling for him to mount. Nearly got it. The attempt cost him. Back to guard. Almost a triangle attempt by Marino. A couple good strikes from the bottom.
Marino has adapted well here.
Yes, he has. He seems to have been able to defense the ground and pound now. Terrell's having a hard time moving up the body and striking.
Gets a couple of kicks out to the midsection as he stands up. Marino was able to smack a couple on him.
Marino doing a very good job from the bottom here. It's rare that you see the bottom fighter really control the fight fully striking. And he has struck very, very well from the bottom.
Marino's game would seem to be standing up and trying for the kicks if he can.
It was interesting. The one time he flurried with him, when it was over, he almost reached to grab over the shoulders, and it was almost an invite to get shot under. And if I were Terrell, I'd do it. You've given me your hips. Might have a replay of it on that first takedown. To see that. They're right in front of us. Good guard by Marino. Controlling the head. The head's down for Terrell, and that limits how much he can strike.
And Marino has gained confidence throughout this fight in that position. Big swing and a miss. If we were going to a baseball game, that would be a swing and a miss by Terrell there. He's not quite able to land those punches with effectiveness.
Corner of Terrell saying head up and punch, and that's that posturing. But he's keeping the head down, and it makes it harder. There you go. Here's corner erupt going, yeah, you need to do that, but it takes a lot of energy, especially when you got to start over after every punch. I like what he's doing. Push the head, then immediately let your hand slide up the head, and in comes the elbow. That was a smart little tactic.
See Marino being able to elude most of those punches. And now he is directly in front of his corner.
And cardio is going to be everything now. Who's got the better shape? This is a grueling fight.
They're in outstanding shape. They're undefeated.
Yeah, these two are really putting a lot of effort in here. He's constantly moving up the body, and Marino doing a good job of adapting and using guard to defend.
Under a minute to go in round two. Terrell on top. He has been in that position most of this round. You have to wonder about the judges, what they're thinking at this stage.
Well, there's been no submission attempts. That's really been the one thing here that hasn't happened. It's all been striking, ground and pound.
And does Terrell get more credit for his two takedowns, especially that one big takedown?
Certainly that's going to score for him, yes, unquestionably. But on the bottom here, I really think Marino has controlled the pace of the fight here. Terrell's doing a good job of trying to move up and strike, but really hasn't been effective. And if Marino gets out here, boy, that would really help him.
Round two is nearing an end. And Terrell is not able to get any room to get any punches in there. Marino, can he make an attempt? His corner was hollering, arm bar, not enough time to even get that going. So we will go to the third round to decide this one.
I mean, I like what Terrell is doing. He's doing a great job. It's just he's not getting his head up well enough to go ahead and deliver effective strikes. If your head's down, everything comes from the outside. And a simple arm-up block will stop that arcing motion before it hits you. Marino, on the other hand, if I were him, I'd want to keep my feet, try to get him coming in and strike him as he's coming in. But as I said before, I saw when they exchanged, he sort of reached up to grab Terrell. And I'm wondering if you're bringing your arms up, your legs are open for the shot. And that's what Terrell has been able to do to Marino, is control where the fight takes place. And he's done it on the ground with himself on top, Terrell.
Well, Vance, here we go with the third and final round of this bout. Let's cheer him on as we enter the center of the cage. This is round three.
Very good fight here. Very technical, evenly matched fighters, both undefeated.
Here we go, third and final round, Terrell and Marino. And this certainly is a test of stamina right now. They have gone at it from the outset of this one. Marino trying to measure off. We haven't seen that one big kick yet. It was deflected in the second round by Terrell.
Kind of a lazy kick by Terrell, almost cost him. He turned his back. Marino's almost had a chance to hit him from behind. And now Terrell is into the body. And this is what Marino does not want. Up against the fence.
Can it be yet another takedown? That has been Terrell's style in the first round and the second round.
He's nearly got his hands locked again. In fact, he does, and he dumps him again.
So the strategy for David Terrell has been to try to keep this on the mat. He has not gotten the ground and pound game going, I'm sure, the way that he would have liked to have had it at this stage.
He's worked really hard to make it effective, but it really hasn't scored that much. There was a couple of early on, he got through the defense and struck Marino, but it's been a while since he really was able to hit him cleanly.
Marino has adapted well in this. Since the very start, when he was looking to his corner, it seemed like the majority of the first round. He hasn't looked there anymore. He's listening to them, but he's done a great job, as you mentioned, Jeff.
He's adjusted. The first round, he got hit, but since then, he really hasn't. Bringing the legs up in there. All that effort resulted in no scoring for Terrell. I mean, he's trying. There's no doubt he's trying.
Figure one thing, if Terrell stands up too quickly, he's got to watch out for an up kick from Marino.
And that's something else that Marino has been doing very well, is when he does get some space, he brings those heels right up. Well, this fight might get brought up. There's not a lot of action right here.
They are in the dead corner. There's nowhere to go right now against the fence.
And that's what's going to happen. They're going to bring him up. Not enough action. Referee John Sorley. And you hear a lot of the fans cheering. They wanted a little bit more going on than that. They've seen two rounds of that.
And Terrell comes in again with the left. Not as effective as we saw earlier.
There's that high kick again. Marino headhunting. This is where he can do his best damage. See, he stays on the outside. Throws those bombs. Might catch Terrell coming in.
You wonder at this stage how close this fight is, how close the judges have scored these first two rounds.
Yeah, I really don't have an opinion on it. It's very, very close. And how do you score that second round? I thought Marino did a very nice job, even though he was on the bottom. Might have been a draw for a round, but I think it's still a very close fight.
You would guess maybe a slight edge for Terrell coming into this third and decisive round.
And Marino now having a chance to score here with some strikes. Looking to try to put him down here, but needs to be careful. This is where a wrestler is dangerous.
He wants to get this back up.
Needs that underhook. That was big. And he gets it. That underhook saved him and actually got him a chance at the takedown. Now what can Marino do to come back? His chance on top for ground and pound. Who knows? Maybe a submission.
Marino trying to get a little leverage over there, and holding on is David Terrell.
You got to wonder right now. Terrell now on his back late in the fight, in a close fight.
And Terrell hasn't been there until now.
Could be a big momentum shift here. Marino starting to drop elbows, even dropping elbows to the thigh. Got him up against the fence. Everything's right now here for Marino, and he's really starting to lay some leather.
Marino is having success at the ground and pound, particularly with those elbows.
This is scoring. That was big. He's got his hands free again. Quick little elbow there.
Marino trying to close it out strong. His corner now telling him, 25 seconds, keep swinging.
Got nothing to do, just leave it all in there. Doesn't do any good to say, look, I'm still breathing easy. I can still go. Leave it out there. This is going to really decide it with the judges.
Elbow after elbow from Marino here in the last minute of this round.
What a great fight. What a great fight.
Couple of more elbows to the thigh, and that's it. Terrell
Bravo.
And Marino, they
Bravo.
Go the distance.
Boy, these two were evenly matched. A lot of heart out there. Marino down the whole time under Terrell, finally gets on top at the end, does some pretty good scoring there.
Will that be enough in what was considered a very close fight? Here we go in about the last minute or so of this fight. For the first time, it was Marino in the ground and pound.
And he was able there to use that left hand, throwing short punches, landing to Terrell's head. And he did score effectively late in that fight. You got to think, late in a round like that, that influences the judges. Especially when there wasn't a whole lot of domination going on.
Exactly right. You remember the start and you remember the finish of most sporting events.
And our judges putting it together, that's Ralph McKnight, Abe Bilardo, John Sorley, but John's in the ring, so I'm not sure. One of the other referees were sitting.
Okay, let's take a look at David Terrell in action. And in the first round and in the second round, he was able to get, this is the first round with that slam of Marino. He did another takedown to start the second round.
Exact same way, using the double, push your opponent into the fence, reach down, lock your hands around the hips, rip them out, get the takedown.
Okay, it is close. It goes to the judges. Terrell and Marino undefeated coming in. One will have their first loss, we expect, and Jimmy Lennon Jr. has the judges' decision.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds of action, we go to the scorecards. We have a unanimous decision. All three judges at cage side score about the same, 29 to 28. All three in favor of the winner, David Terrell.
David Terrell has now run his record to 4-0. Mike Marino suffering his first pro loss. And perhaps those takedowns stayed in the minds of the judges. It was a close one, but a unanimous decision win for David Terrell.
Now, Terrell did a great job with those takedowns, controlled a lot of the fight. Marino came back late, but Terrell built up the lead.
Terrell still undefeated. He's standing by with Ron Kruk. Ron.
Okay, thanks, Kenny. David Terrell, this was a brutal, very technical fight coming into this. You said you wanted to keep it on the ground. What was the key to this fight?
Taking him down, grounding and pounding him.
It definitely worked. You said that you spent 6 weeks up at Big Bear with Tito Ortiz. How key was that for your cardio? Because this was a long and brutal fight.
It was great training. It was a great experience. I'm glad to have trained with Tito Ortiz, Kendall Grove, Melvin Galar, Josh Berkman. They had a real good camp out there. And I'm glad I went out there and trained. You got me in shape.
David Terrell, you remain undefeated. Congratulations. Kenny, back to you.
Thanks, Ron. Tough fight tonight. David Terrell and Mike Marino, they go to the limit. Terrell comes away with unanimous decision victory to go 4-0. World Extreme Cage Fighting action here on HDNet. We get ready for light heavyweights making their way to the cage. Justin, the Hawk Hawes, against Justin, the Executioner Levins.
Oh, Justin Hawes out of Connecticut, Bend, Oregon, with the Desert Dogs. JT Taylor up there. 6 years he's been a fighter. Works as a framer and also as security. And he's also done Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu for 6 years. A purple belt under JT Taylor, but also trains under Marcelo Alonso, a very good instructor.
And now Justin Levins, Californian with a 7-3 record. He's had three straight losses, trying to get that turned around here in the cage tonight.
And that's really his motivation right now. He's been to the UFC. He had a chance at big time. And he needs now a victory to get himself back, you know, the momentum that he had.
Certainly three tough losses that he's had.
Yeah, he did. And he needs to get his career back on track. So this is a big fight for him. He's moving up in weight. Perhaps that signaling he really wants to make an impression here.
So Laws and Levin's both fighting a weight class higher than they normally would.
They're both up right here. Both need victories to get their careers jump-started, but I think there's probably a little bit more pressure on the executioner, Levin's.
And Hawes has had a neck injury that has slowed him down in his training and in his fighting.
I was distracted. I apologize. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, the WEC Ring Girls. But yeah, Levin's is ready to go. This should be an entertaining fight. The unknown thing is Hawes. I have not seen Hawes fight.
Hawes has experience as an amateur. As a pro, he says he has a record of 4-3-1 coming into this.
That's the official record.
Here's Jimmy Lennon Jr. with the official introduction.
Ladies and gentlemen, from the Tachi Palace Hotel and Casino, at this time we present WEC Light Heavyweights in the Cage. We're scheduled 3 5-minute rounds. Introducing to you first on my right, fighting out of the blue corner, standing 5 feet 11 inches, he weighed in at 198 pounds. He's a freestyle fighter with a record of 3 wins, 3 losses, and 1 draw. Representing Desert Dogs and hailing from Bend, Oregon, introducing Justin the Hawk Hawes. And his opponent across the cage on my left, he is fighting out of the red corner. Standing 5 feet 11, he weighed in at 198 pounds. Specializing in Vale Tudo, his record stands at 7 wins and 3 losses. Fighting out of Marcus Huas, Vale Tudo, and hailing from Laguna Niguel, California, please welcome Justin, the Executioner Levin. A referee in charge of this bout is Josh Rosenthal. Once again, we're scheduled 3 5-minute rounds.
Hawes with a neck injury, trying to get back in the groove. Levin's with 3 tough fights, 3 straight losses, trying to get back in the winning ways. It is scheduled for 3 5-minute rounds. Round one is underway. Two guys that we expect will be on their feet swinging as much as possible in this.
And Hawes, a southpaw.
Big kick there by Levin's. He loses balance and goes down.
No real damage done there. Hawes jumped right on top of him, but let's see what he can do while in this position. He's trying to posture up. And he gets to side mount on Levin's. Levin's able to bustle his way up, and he works his way back to his feet. And he delivers a double leg and puts Hawes down.
Levin's going to work now. We will see how long he wants to keep it here on the ground.
Levin's losing streak started with Scott Smith here at the WEC and then went to the UFC with Evan Tanner and George Santiago.
His corner telling him no hurry. Hits a couple punches in. They're telling him now, go for the elbow next time you have a chance.
See how Levin's has developed, passing the guard, creating some space for the opportunity to strike. Hawes trying to keep that space closed. Maybe look for a submission. There's a snap up looking for a triangle. And Hawes is going to get passed here by Levin's. Side mount, but Levin's chooses to strike. It's to the other side.
Donovan's is going in. That's it.
He's out.
That's it. He landed 2 quick blows, and Hawes is out. Justin Levin's is back. He snapped out of it and snapped off 2 punches.
Well, that's been his success, is he's got tremendous power in those hands, and once he hits you once or twice, he can take you right out.
Now look how quick it is.
That one right there is going to put him out. and two, three in the elbow.
And the elbow, and quickly, Josh Rosenthal, the referee, moves in to stop that one.
Well, that first punch right there, you see him go down. Rosenthal knows he's out, moves right in, stops any more damage.
Nice move there by the ref, I must say, for Josh Rosenthal.
Left hand, and then there, switching sides. Yeah, you saw his arms go down.
That's it.
I knew he was partially out there. That elbow, though, was vicious. Even though that arm came up, it actually stopped that next one from coming down. Levins, explosive victory there.
Justin Levins did all the damage in a span of about 7-8 seconds. Bang, 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 and that was the end of this fight. As Hawes continues to be administered to, he was knocked out.
He was out. Doctor taking their time with him. His feet are moving, he's wiggling his fingers. He seems to be okay, but they're taking the side of safety here, caution, taking their time with him. This ought to open some doors for Levins. Needed a victory like this, put himself back in the game. Jumpstart his career again, get another opportunity and work in the bigger show, more money, and a big shot at the title. Got power in his hands, he really does.
Well, power and quickness about him. We've seen guys in similar positions, Jeff, throughout, that throw the punches, but they're not able to get that direct hit as Levins was able to in rapid succession.
And I liked how he jumped from side to side. He had side mount on the left, threw the punch, and then immediately transferred over to the right, threw the punch. And that one that came through, that first one knocked him, looked like he went out there, and then a couple more, and then that one elbow, and Josh Rosenthal said he saw enough.
You heard the applause as you see the Hawk, Justin Hawes, is now sitting up because he was knocked out. Guys are sometimes knocked down. We call it a knockout. Of course, it is. They're not able to answer right away, and maybe 10 seconds later, they can sit up and say, wow, why'd you stop it?
Right, but this, he definitely was out. Levins with a big victory there. Good job. And the WEC, we've never had any kind of real major injury here either in any of our fights. And they're taking no chances here with Hawes, making sure he's okay.
Let's go to the ring now, and it's good to see Justin Hawes is back on his feet. Justin Levins will have his hand raised by the referee. Jimmy Lennon Jr. will make it all official.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have a time of 1 minute, 28 seconds in round number one. He is the winner by way of knockout, Justin, the Executioner Levins.
Levins from Laguna Niguel, California, and you talk about a way to jump back into it, snapped that three-fight losing streak, and was really impressive about how quickly he was able to land those punches.
Well, champions only need a little bit of an opening, and once they get it, they know how to score. Levins saw it, and he was able to take out his opponent. To Hawes' credit, he's had a bad neck in the past. He's come back. He's trained. He was ready to fight, but he was a late replacement.
Levins now is standing by with Ron Kruk. Ron.
Okay, Kenny, thank you. Justin Levins, you came in extremely focused and said that you were going to end this with a first-round knockout. Well, your prediction came true.
Yeah, that's what I like to do. I like to come in, knock people out first round so I can go home. And
Justin, I know you want to see it, so let's take a look at the replay and talk us through it.
That's it. Elbow. Yeah, it's pretty much out. I couldn't get my arms out from under from the guard, so when I finally passed, I just let loose.
Right.
I had a real focus this fight. I had 3 losses in a row. I've become undefeated. I just came out of the UFC. I'm happy. Maybe I can get back in, man, you know. I need a couple more wins. Maybe they'll take me back.
Well, absolutely. You have won your first 7, and then you're in the middle of a 3-fight losing streak, as you said. 1 here in the WEC, 2 in the UFCs. Was there a sense of urgency to get that win tonight?
I think my career depended on it.
Wow. Well, congratulations. This was huge for you.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank Hitman Fight Gear, Apex, Marco Hua, Sure Dog, WEC, Rockstar, Scott Adams for bringing me back. Thanks a lot, guys.
Nice job. Okay, Kenny, back to you, cage side.
Thanks, Ron. He threw a punch, and he just threw it right out there, didn't he? A must fight, he said.
Yeah, there was no doubt his career was on the verge right there. Those 3 straight losses, the opportunity at the UFC, he's resurrected the opportunity to get back to the big show.
He's now 8-3, and he looks like he is back. Justin, the Executioner Levins. We'll be back with our WEC lightweight fight. John Polakowski against Olaf Alfonso here on HDNet. Welcome back to World Extreme Cage Fighting here on HDNet. I'm Kenny Rice along with Jeff Blatnick and Ron Kruk. As we get ready for WEC lightweight action, John Polakowski against Olaf Alfonso. They have a rich, entertaining, interesting, and a little scary, their history. And now with more on one of the fighters, Ron Kruk.
Guys, in 2004, Olaf and John Polakowski put on a fight that many believe to be the fight of the year in mixed martial arts. In 2005, the sequel, unfortunately, did not live up to the original when Olaf injured a hip and could not finish the fight. Tonight, these two warriors meet for a third time. To this day, many consider that first Olaf Polakowski fight to be one of the best in the history of the sport. Do not blink tonight, because we expect much of the same.
Thanks, Ron. There's almost a feel that a championship is at stake in this rubber match between John Polakowski and Olaf Alfonso. As you just saw, what a fight they had. Almost like round one of their careers against each other.
It went back and forth several times. Momentum swings, vicious shots on the ground, standing. It even got a little bit bloody. But it showed heart. The people responded. I mean, that was an unbelievably vicious and at the same time highly entertaining fight. Those two laid it on the line. Second ended in a Olaf injury, was not able to come out and answer the bell. But they're together here for the rubber match. One all. And Polakowski's come away. It's the only, he's only fought third fight, all of them against Olaf.
This is his career. As Polakowski getting ready to come in, as you look at the tail of the tape in this one. And Olaf making a rare appearance outside of Puerto Vallarta, Mexico. He said this is a place he wants to fight, the World Extreme Cage Fighting. He loves to come here to the Tachi Palace Hotel and Casino in Lemoore, California, and they certainly love both these guys. They love to see them in action.
You know, Polakowski's a youngster. Olaf, you know, you ask him his age, he's sort of like my mom. He doesn't like letting us know how old he is. And he's been that way the whole time. Back, nobody, hardly anybody knows Alfonso's his last name. Everybody knows him as Olaf. And I dubbed him the ageless one, and he liked it. I'll tell you what, when he comes out there, win or lose, he brings it. And the fans love him for it.
He has a 5-5 record. He has lost his last three, but we're talking the top shelf competition.
Yeah, he's even been to the UFC now. And certainly, you know, UFC Pride. And, you know, when you're up against people like that, it becomes very, very difficult. Razor Rob McCullough here at the WEC, he lost to him. And, of course, that Polakowski in the rematch, but he's looking to make amends here in the rubber match.
And here comes Olaf making his way to the ring. Acknowledging the crowd.
And what a character. You know, if anything, what a character. He's the kind of guy like Forrest Gump where if you came up to him on a park bench, you'd be there all day talking to him.
And he is a magnet. Other fighters, as well as fans, they all gravitate to Olaf when he's around. John Polakowski, meanwhile, he's been in the cage, it seems like, for about 20 minutes already. Not quite that long as Olaf comes in. And now, here's Jimmy Lennon Jr. with the official introductions.
Ladies and gentlemen, from the Taachi Palace Hotel and Casino here in Lemoore, California, at this time we present a WEC lightweight rematch special attraction scheduled 3 5-minute rounds. Introducing to you first on my right, he is fighting out of the blue corner, standing 5 feet 9 inches. He